And y'all, I am excited. So can y'all get up on your feet and help me welcome up Nate?
Stay up here, Meg. Stay up here, Meg. So you guys, you know, gave it up for me, but you guys need to give it up for Meg, because Meg is doing an amazing job stewarding this campus, leading this campus. You're doing a great job. You're seen. Keep on doing it, because God knows your heart. So just keep on being faithful and be blessed. So let's get it. We love Meg. Meg's one of my peeps, so I got to shout her out when I get a chance. Thank you, Pastor Tyra, for having me come here tonight. Pastor Tyra's away getting some much-needed time with the Lord and some conferencing and some words. So, like, you know, you guys give it up for Pastor Tyra. And then also, you know, we have the privilege of having the Pastor Brandon here today. You know, the Pastor Brandon is here. So my name's Nate. I attend Amplify. I don't know if any of you guys ever seen me before. I've been here once or twice. And so tonight I'm going to be talking to you guys about a couple different things, but the main thing is going to be purpose, right? So, and, you know, we'll have a title of a message and everything, but the main thing is going to be purpose. And so, you know, from the onset, I just want you to think about, like, what do you think about when I first say purpose? You know what I mean? So, like, you know, value, you know, what it means to have it. And so we're going to start it off with an example. So I need four volunteers. I need four volunteers. One, come on up. Two, come on up. Three, come on up. Four, come on up. Nope, you. You come up. All right. Okay, so we got four people. Can you guys see? Everybody can see them? Right, okay. So, we got four people here, so I'm gonna ask you a question. So, you had the opportunity, someone came up to you and said, hey, I want to give you something. Okay, right? Hold on. We're going to do something here. Look, someone said, I'm going to give you $1. Right? $1. It's yours. You can do whatever you want with it, right? They said, I'm going to give you $5. It's yours. It's $5. You can do whatever you want with it, right? I'm going to give you $10. It's yours. You can do whatever you want. Get whatever you want. And then they say, you know what? I'm going to give you $20. Right? So we got $1, $5, $10, $20, right? So if you're looking at it, right, just off the onset, who do you think has the most value in their hand right now? Kate, right, because it's a larger amount, right? But what if Kate said, you know what? I'm going to keep all this money for myself. Go sit down. You know? And what if Dom said, you know what? I'm going to keep all this money for myself. And what if Rocco said, you know what? I'm going to buy my friend. Never mind. I'm going to keep this money for myself. And Allie said, even though I only have $1, you know what I'm going to do? What's the Compassion Kid's name? I'm going to give James that $1 because I know that this $1 would help James out a lot more. Right, so she gives James that $1. So she plants a seed. She gives James this $1. She pours it out from what she has, right? But then before Allie walks away, because she chose to be faithful with this little bit and pour it out instead of keeping it, What if as she was walking away, Allie's walking away, they were like, Allie, wait, you forgot something. And they said, Allie, here's $100. So who had the most value in their hand? Who had the most value? Because that, you know, from the onset, you would say, okay, Cade had $20. It was Cade, right? Yeah, Cade had $20, so it looked the most. But with the most, he did the least. And then next was Dom. Dom had 10. You know, Dom probably could have did something, so he had it, and he had the opportunity to do something with it. But Dom was like, you know what? I'm going to keep this opportunity right here. Wow. And then Rocco was like, you know, I don't have as much as Cade and Dom, but I have something. And then I thought about doing something with it, and I was like, you know what? It's not as much as Cade and Dom, so I'm not going to do anything. Wow. So I'm going to go sit down with it. But then Allie was like, I only have one. But instead of doing nothing with it, I'm going to do something with it. And the something I did with it turned into much more. Wow. So what if I told you it's not about what you have, it's about what you give. Wow. So starting, it's not about what you have, it's about what you give when it comes to purpose. See, a lot of times we want to keep purpose for ourselves, not realizing that the purpose that we have is actually for everyone else. When you pour your purpose out for the kingdom of God, you will see great and amazing things. So the title of today's message is Everything Bottled Up Must Be Broken. So, we've been reading in this story. There's a story we're going to read, passage. It's about Mary. She's in the Bible. And, you know, Jesus is there, and Lazarus is actually there. You guys know who Lazarus is. Lazarus is the man that Jesus' good friend, the one Jesus loved, that he raised from the dead. He's there. They're at a dinner. And Jesus is in town. And so Jesus is in Bethany. And so, a lot of people don't know this, but, you know, Jesus is about to die. And so Jesus knows this. He's told his disciples this. But I'm going to read a story and a passage, and we're going to go over a couple of things. And, you know, a lot of times I say you can get a lot of different things out of a message or a different passage. You know, some people might say, oh, I thought this or I thought that. So when I read this passage, this is what I got out of it, and I want to share it with you. So if you guys could lock in for a few minutes, I won't be before you long. But I'm going to try not to do it wrong. Stop it, Brandon. All right. So we're reading out of John 12, chapter 3, out of the NLT. So the NLT is a New Living Translation. It says, then Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume made from the essence of nard. So, like, that's the equivalent of, I was saying the other night, that's not the cologne or perfume you get at Ross. You know, when you check out at Ross, you get a pair of socks, you're like, Mom, I don't want to smell bad after practice, so I need to get the blue bottle. And she's like, okay, grab it. No. This is the stuff you get like at Nordstrom's or at a high-end store. This is like the best of the best, right? So that you might not be able to buy this for a dollar, you might have to spend. You gotta call Allie, come with me to the store. We gotta go buy this. I need your help. Right? And so then expensive perfume, essence of nard. She anointed Jesus' feet with it, wiping his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance. That's how strong it was. So they're in a house. Just picture this. Jesus, I'm assuming, he just got done eating. And, you know, when we get done eating, we like to chill, relax. So Jesus is on the couch or on a stack of hay. I don't know what they had inside the house. But he's there. He's chilling. And so she comes up to him, and she sits down, and she pours this perfume on his feet, and she starts to wash his feet with her hair. And then, so the house was filled with the fragrance. But Judas Iscariot, the disciple who would soon betray him, said, "The perfume was worth a year's wages. It should have been sold. The money should have been sold for the poor and given to the poor." And I was like, I'm reading it. So like I pause. I'm like, this is like Jesus' boy. He's been with him through all of his miracles. He's on a boat with him. You know, when Jesus calmed the storm, he was there when Jesus fed the 5,000 men with two fish and five loaves of bread. So he's seen all these things. And he sees this person trying to honor him. And then you would think, he was like, okay, yeah, I'm going to honor you too. But he started to hate on him. And so I said before, it's so wild that like the people who you consider so close to you low-key hate on you. We call it sneak dissing. I don't know, I think that's what y'all call it still. I don't know. I'm not on TikTok. But, so I don't know. But we would call it sneak dissing. It'd be like, all right, like, you know, good job. You know, I played football in high school and college and, you know, and so you play football. And so, you know, you would go to practice and you would play on a Friday night and you would score a touchdown. And you would always watch for, like, the one person who was, like, not celebrating for you. Even though they were on your team, same jersey, they're cool with you. But you were just watching. They were like, ah, like, okay, good job, cool, congrats. But you could see it out the side of their eye, like, ah, like they're not really for me, you know what I mean? And so like, that's what Judas was. Judas was like that person who, like, he was there for the benefit. That's it. Whatever, he could just benefit himself. And so it says, not that he cared for the poor, but he was a thief. Since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole from them for himself. And then this is how great Jesus is. Jesus replied, "Leave her alone. She did this in preparation for my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." So we're going to pray. You know, Father God, thank you for today. Thank you that the reading of your word has touched this room, Father God. Let them be attached to this word and our hearts be open as we speak tonight, Father God. Let it be your words and not my words, Father God. Let the words that you have come into my mouth touch their hearts, Father God, that they can just be connected more to you. In Jesus' name. So reading that passage, what I got out of it is that Mary had purpose, and she could access the purpose, and it was valuable to her. And so the reason why I did like the illustration before is to show you that it's not the amount of purpose you have, it's what you do with the amount of purpose you have, right? So Allie's $1 went a whole lot further because she was obedient to what she had in her hand when she poured it out. And understand, Allie didn't give me a quarter. Allie didn't give me 50 cents. Allie didn't give me 75 cents. Allie gave me a buck. Allie gave me the whole thing. And so this is where we slip up with purpose. We only want to give a partial purpose and receive a full reward. So we only want to give a little bit, but get a lot back. And so we only want to do like this, and we'd be frustrated and upset when we don't receive everything else. And so like in saying this, I'm encouraging you that like while dealing with purpose, make sure that you're attaching it to the right thing. Because it's easy to find yourself searching for purpose when you should be searching for your identity. And your identity is what God has called you to be. So we get attached so much trying to find what we're supposed to do and not realizing who we are. And a lot of times when you find out who you are in Christ, that will clear the path and way of what you're supposed to be doing. A lot of times we find ourselves in situations as young adults and young people that we don't need to be in because we have allowed someone else to define our purpose. So I'm hanging out with a group of people and, you know, I know what they're doing is not right, but they're cool with me. They accept me. They don't talk bad about me. They care about me. So I believe because, you know, they invite me in. And so a lot of times we say, you know what, whatever they say, I'm going to do. Whatever they do, I'm going to be a part of. But the problem with that is a lot of times what they do is not of God. And so a lot of times when we're attaching ourselves because of a feeling to a purpose, we're actually distracted from where we're supposed to be. And the reason why we're distracted is because we've taken our eyes off the prize. And it's so easy to do. Like, I'm not talking down on you guys. I believe I'm trying to encourage you because I lived it. So in high school, I was the person who, if it wasn't cool, I didn't want to be a part of it. Right, so, you know, I mean, I knew what I was supposed to do. So like, as a child, I was told, you know, you're supposed to preach the word of God, and you're supposed to, you know, do this for the kingdom of God, and you're supposed to do that for the kingdom of God, and this, and this. So I was like, okay, you know, younger, I'm good. And the moment I got to high school, I got some freedom. I was like, all right, I'm going to try to do everything else than what when I was told to do as a child. So I caught myself in situations. I found myself in areas that I wasn't supposed to be in. And what's crazy is that the situations that I was in, I should have never been in if I was obedient to where I was supposed to be. A lot of times we find ourselves in situations because we're out of pocket. And that means we're not where we're supposed to be because we're trying to fit in somewhere else. And so, you know, I would always catch myself in areas and situations. I'm going to be vulnerable and honest. In high school, I started, you know, using drugs, smoking weed. This is the most I did. I didn't like, what's crazy part is I didn't even like doing it. I did it because the people around me were doing it. I didn't enjoy doing it. I did it because the people around me were doing it. And I wonder how many of you young people in this room today find yourselves doing things that you don't even want to do, but you do it because you feel accepted. You feel accepted. So if I don't do this, they won't like me, so I have to do it. So if I don't say this, they won't like me, so I have to say it. If I don't wear this, they won't like me, so I have to wear it. Tonight I'm encouraging you, but also I'm letting you know you don't have to do what they say. You don't have to attach yourself to those people. You don't have to attach yourself to those things. So I'm going to ask you guys a question. Majority of you guys are here, like, what, 14, 15, 13, 25. old man Brandon. If someone came to you guys right now and was like, hey, what's your purpose? What would you say? You know? Any idea? Yeah. To spread the word of God. Love it. Love it. What about you? You don't know, which is fair. I'm not saying you got to know, you know, because I was teaching semesters last night, and you know, and someone came basically afterwards, basically saying the same thing, like, oh, what if you don't know what your purpose is? And I'm like, a lot of people don't know what their purpose is, but that's actually, what if I said that's actually a great thing? Because if you don't know what your purpose is, that's even more of a reason to attach yourself more to the kingdom of God. So you don't know where you're supposed to be, well, why not go to a sheltered place? See, when you go to a sheltered place, it protects you from a lot of different storms that you're never supposed to be in. So a lot of times we walk through a lot of different storms and fail to access and go where we're supposed to be because we left the shelter before it was time to go. And so like this room right here is a shelter place. I thank God for my youth room. It was Thursday nights, too. It's crazy. It was Thursday nights. Thursday night, 7:30, Pasadena, California. It was our youth group. It was youth night. And, you know, to think that, like, you know, this is an opportunity that you guys have. If you don't know your purpose, know that you're perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with it. You don't have to know your purpose, but I definitely want you to know your God. It's okay. You don't know your purpose. I don't know what I want to do in this right now. But what I want you to know is that he is good, he is great, he is loving, and he is more than enough. So even though you don't know what you want to do, I encourage you to keep him inside of you, to keep him close to you, to stay attached to this community, to stay attached to your leaders here and to the people around you. It's easy to find yourself, you know, wondering, like, the what ifs, who am I, what am I supposed to do? And I am going to read this. I don't think I gave it to you to put on there, so I'm just going to read it. This comes out of Isaiah. It's Isaiah 30, 19 through 21. Did it go on there? Okay, great. My man. Okay. Old people of Zion who live in Jerusalem. So this is talking the older time, but we'll put today's words in. O youth group of Amplify who live in Plum. You will weep no more. He will be gracious if you ask for help. He will surely respond to the sounds of your cries. Understand what he's saying. This is Old Testament. This is Old Covenant. Though the Lord gave you adversity for food and suffering for drink, he will still be with you to teach you. You will see your teachers with your own eyes. Meg, wave your hand. Your ears will hear them. Right behind you, a voice will say, this is the way you should go, whether right or left. When you feel lost, when you feel like you don't know where to go, this right here is telling you, when you're connected to him, he will always guide your path. A lot of times we try to pick our own path instead of being submitted to the path that's laid before us. So I want to encourage you guys tonight. And again, this was not the sermon that I was preaching, but this is what I'm teaching, so we're rocking with it. I'm encouraging you guys. You know, tonight, we're going to have like a moment of worship. We're going to have a moment of prayer. But tonight, you know, the Bible says, like, let a man examine his heart, or woman examine his heart, their heart. And what that's saying is, like, you know, you guys are grown, so I'm going to talk to you like you're grown. Look at yourselves. Look inside yourselves. And just ask God, because God is so cool and so chill, you could just talk to him. Under the new covenant, you don't have to do all the old things that you used to do. You can go to God right now and have a conversation with him. Majority of my prayer time is straight conversation with God. Like, oh, what do I do here? I'm talking to him. People might think I'm talking to myself. A lot of times my daughter, like, you're talking to yourself. I might be talking to myself, but I might be talking to God too. And so just have a conversation with him. Because, I mean, like that pastor says, he hears you. He hears you. You know, God, what do I do here? I don't want to hang out with these people no more, and I don't know how to stop doing it. What do I do? I don't want to do this thing anymore, but I don't know how to stop. What do I do? I don't want to put myself in this position anymore, but I just can't stop doing it. What do I do? Stop asking your friends and ask him. Stop asking people who did not create you and ask your creator. Because it's so easy to go to a comfortable answer. If they're doing the same thing you're doing and you go to them for help, you're both going to drown. There's an old saying, can the blind lead the blind? It's like, yes, but they'll both fall into the same hole. And so you have to make sure, like, who you're attaching yourself to is heading in the direction that you want to go. the people you're around is not where you currently are, but where you want to go. I try to make sure that anybody that I'm around is going further than I already am, and they're not leaving me behind. See, a true friend, if you're running in a race and you're 8 legs behind, isn't going to tell you, hey, bro, catch up, catch up, catch up. No. A true friend is going to jog back, come beside you and say, come on, let's go. Just go. They're not going to fall into the same hole with you, but they're going to make sure that as they pull you out, they're going to encourage you to keep going forward. If you're hanging with someone who continually causes you to fall, you should stop hanging on them. Because if they're continually causing you to fall, there's a great chance they're hindering your purpose. Not that they're a bad person, it's just that in this season, they're not prepared for you. So, I'm gonna be done, but I wanna encourage you guys on a few things. So, with purpose, I wanna encourage you guys tonight that don't be afraid to show your purpose, especially if it's for the kingdom of God. The Bible says, shine your light so men might see Jesus living inside of you. And so my encouragement to you is with that, don't be afraid to shine your lights. The world needs to see more people like you and less of themselves. They need to see people who have hope, who have peace, who have joy, who have understanding, who have health, because they may not tell you that they need that, but they show you. So a lot of times, like, if you just watch and see what's around you, you can see, okay, let me try to love this person. What if your purpose wasn't to be on stage or wasn't to be seen? What if your purpose was just to be, every day you see this man who you know he's struggling with, and you'd be like, hey, Jesus loves you, bro. And if you need anything, I'm here for you. That's it. What if that was your purpose? What if your purpose wasn't to be anything like miraculous or great, just to say, listen, I know you're struggling, man, but Jesus loves you, bro. We're here for you. And if you need me, I'm here for you. And it's not, we don't have to have a deep conversation. I don't matter what's going on. And, oh, you know, I'm not here to gossip. What if it's just like, you know, like, I know things may not be great at home, but, you know, but Jesus loves you. What if your greatest purpose right now in your life was just to come here every Thursday and just be faithful? You know what? I'm going to be a part of this. Why? Because I'm not ready to go up to him and shake his hand, but I am ready to sit here and receive something so that, like, in a week or two or a month or two, when I go up to him and shake his hand, it's going to be solid. It's going to be able to receive something from me. So don't believe that you don't have something inside of you that can change the world. Don't believe that you don't have something inside of you that can change your school, that can change your home, that can change your family. What if you, being obedient, coming here on Wednesday, Thursday, and coming here on Sunday, connecting to the house here, what if you're the person that's going to actually bring your parent into church, or your grandparent, or your cousin, or your best friend? You know, I'll never go to church. It's okay, you don't gotta go to church. This is the greatest thing that one of my buddies told me, and this will stick with me forever. He said, remember this, you might be the only Bible that someone ever reads. You might be the only Bible that someone ever reads, which means that, like, you might be the only person that they ever get a chance to see and meet Jesus through. You. But how great is that? How honorable is that you are the person that they get to see to meet their Savior, to now be free, to have the joy that you guys all have access to. How great is that? Don't ever think that you're too small for your purpose. Don't ever think that you're not capable of your purpose. If God placed it in you, he equipped you to activate it, to use it, to be great at it. God doesn't make junk. God makes excellence. So when he saw you, he said it was good. That means you're good. You may not always do good, but you're good. You may not always say good, but you are good. So don't allow frustrations of the past, mistakes of the past, any of that to define your purpose. Your purpose is who God says you are, not who you say you are. So when you're going through it and you feel down and you feel X, Y, and Z, that's not your purpose. Your purpose is I'm a child of the King. And so like when I'm going through this, oh, I may go through this right now, but I'm a child of the King. And so tonight, if you came in here and you say, you know what, like I know I'm capable and I know this, but I still have a little bit of this. I still, you know, hang out with this person, but I know I shouldn't, but I'm not strong enough to say I want to walk away from that person because, like, they're the only person I eat lunch with at school. Or they're the only person that, like, texts me back. Or they're the only person who truly understands how I feel at night. Or they're the, you know, so I got to stay connected to them because if I don't have them, I won't have anyone. You will have someone. See, the great thing about Jesus, he said, when I leave, that I'm sending you a helper. So he sent the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit will be there for you. And the Holy Spirit is much better at helping you than anybody else is. So you're like, you know, but I can't do, you know, no. Sometimes, like, God wants you to, like, to be away from some people so he can put the right people around you. Sometimes it got to take you saying, you know what? I'm not going to be around this person anymore so that God could put the right person around me. And it may seem like, oh, like, this is terrible. And, you know what I mean? Like, no one cares about me. No, he cares about you. Why? Because he never leaves you nor forsakes you. Right? So if he never leaves you and he never forsakes you, you're never alone. You know? So, you know, we're going to have a moment. And, you know, I'm not, like, super huge on, like, you know, like, you gotta do this because the music's playing, you know, or, you know, you gotta do this because, like, someone's telling you to do it. Like, if you want to do something, like, it's your choice. Like, our God is that cool and that great and that loving that he's like, you know what, if you don't want me, I'm still right here, but I'm not gonna force you. But if you don't want to be free, like, I'm not gonna force you, but I don't want to let you know that you can be free. You don't have to feel that way anymore. You don't have to cry at night. You don't have to live with depression. You don't have to live with anxiety. You don't have to live with X, Y, and Z. You know why? Because, like, I'm good. Like, I'm here. But come. But come. You know, and it's in. So, if you're, we can stand up. And so, you know, like, this is my encouragement to you. It's not even going to be a challenge. It's going to be an encouragement. Because I believe, like, you guys have been challenged your whole lives, but I want to make sure you guys are encouraged. Not manipulated, not forced, not coerced, but challenged. If you feel like you are in a place where you shouldn't be anymore, but you don't know how to walk out of that place, and you've been afraid to ask for help, I'm gonna ask you to do something crazy bold. Crazy. Crazy, crazy, crazy. Why? Because I'm gonna be honest with you, people may look at you. People may look at you. But boy, I'm gonna tell you this. When you walk up and do this, I can promise you, you ain't gonna worry about who's looking at you. Because the freedom that you're walking in is going to be so much greater than someone else's opinion. And the crazy part about it is the people looking at you might be battling the same thing and they're not bold enough right at this moment to come to the front. They might not be bold enough to release it. So, like, you know what I mean? Like, we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the good thing about our God is it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Why? Because he loves us. He cares for us. Cherishes us. So, like, even though we have fallen short, yeah, he's right here. I got you. And, like, are you guys perfect? No. Will you be perfect tomorrow? No. Will you be perfect next year? No. But he's perfect. He's perfect. He's perfect. He's perfect. Your mistake, he's perfect. Oh, I slipped up, picked up. He's perfect. I started hanging out with him again. He's perfect. You know, anything, you, no matter what you're doing, He's perfect. And the great thing about his perfection is when you have him, what God sees is him, not you. So God doesn't see your mistakes and your mistakes. God sees his perfection. His perfection is your protection. So like when you're here, like he's there. He's covering you. And so like in this moment, if you choose to, I'm gonna have you guys have you come down. We were gonna have you go off to the side, but I believe that there's a freedom like when you come down to like the altar. And like all the altar is that it's a place that you can lay something down and release it, and it's given away. So if you have that in your heart, and you say, you know what, I just want like to, if you want someone to pray with you, we're here, we can pray with you, but maybe you just need to come down and just kneel at the altar and have a moment with God. You know, I mean, like, I remember it was 14, and I was at church camp up in Big Bear, California. It was summer, and it was like, you know, like, all right, there was a song, and it was called Jesus, Lover of My Soul. So it was playing, like, all camp, you know what I mean, and I was like, yeah, okay, yeah, like, I like the song, whatever, but I'll never forget, like, it was a moment, like, this song came on. I want to say it's probably the second to last day of camp, and like this song came on, and like I just started like feeling something. It was coming, and it was like, you know, it goes like, Jesus, lover of my soul, Jesus, I will never let you go, you know. And so like, and it was like, and something at that moment captivated me, and I was like, all right, like what is happening here? And like, and I believe at that moment is like the moment like where I was filled with the Holy Spirit. So like, I had a moment, I came down, and have I been perfect since that moment? No. Have I sinned since that moment? Yes. Have I fallen short since that moment? Yes. But they can't ever take that moment from me. So maybe this is the moment. Maybe when you go home, you're going to have a moment. But like right now, all we're doing is providing you opportunity. If you want to have this moment, or if you want to have a moment, to provide you with a safe space. So if you want to come down, we're going to have some worship. We have some people here to pray with you. If you don't even want to pray with you, you just want to sit down and just ask God, you know, like, what am I supposed to do, or how can I do this? The altar is open.